A Broadway stage could only suggest a beautiful setting like this for the musical play On a Clear Day You Can See Forever. In fact, the entire concept seemed uniquely suited to be put on film and expanded on the motion picture screen. Barbara Streisand, the star of the new film, is playing her role in a whole new world beyond the limits of the stage. A world of cameras, of lights, and of sound. A world of the movie makers. When Alan J. Lerner begins to adapt one of his hit musicals for the screen, he starts with setting up a base of operations in his office at a Hollywood studio. From here, he slowly works his way into the project, looking for collaborators in the important areas of production and direction, teaming up with some of the best talent in the business.
Anna.
With actress Barbara Streisand.
Clear Day.
With producer Howard Koch.
Look around.
With director Vincent Minnelli.
And you'll see.
Much of the film is to be shot here on the sound stages of the studio. But the producers also plan to use many real settings, some in England, and some, like this restaurant in a plush New York hotel. Barbara is a girl named Daisy Gamble, and Eve Montand, her psychiatrist, that she becomes emotionally involved with. In the story, she becomes very upset after one of their appointments and has a hard time falling asleep. Since this scene in her bedroom is to be played as a musical number, director Minnelli works out the dramatic sense of the situation in detail before Barbara is ready to sing the song.
What am I going to do about
the challenge in the scene is that she has to sing in counterpoint to the voice of her conscience.
But I don't care. You have to care because you're engaged to him. And you don't have to care about him because how do you know he cares about you? Then what are you going to do?
When you wake up, they may not be there. Go to sleep. And when
originally, Daisy went to her psychiatrist to stop her smoking habits through hypnosis. But the moment she fell into a trance, she began to reveal several previous incarnations in different centuries in England. To shoot these sequences, Howard Koch moves the company to England. They'll use buildings like this Royal Pavilion, which has been around for several hundred years. It was erected by King George IV for his court to take the salty air, and all the swells showed up those days, including Lady Moorpark, who Daisy recalls from a previous life.
Spectacles at once. Mm-hmm. Harry. Now look. Look directly across the lawn. Do you see Diana Smallwood?
Unmistakably Diana Smallwood.
Who is that with her?
Robert Tentries.
Is he married?
No, but he should have been many times.
the film is mounted in stunning style. Designers Cecil Beaton and John DeCour, both Oscar winners, set about to create this opulent setting. DeCour dressed this huge dining room with rich and luxurious artifacts and trappings, and Beaton costumed the players and Barbara in the elegant fashions of the Regency period of England.
My dearest love, who existed in a dream till this evening, when a wave came and swept me out to sea.
Daisy also tells her psychiatrist about a less fortunate life she spent in an 18th century English orphanage. To provide that kind of an atmosphere is another challenge for the company, particularly cinematographer Harry Stradling. He has to light the set in subdued tones of browns and blues to back up the rough time Barbara spends as an orphan.
And scrubbed, oh. And I ate, ugh. Our postman, Mr. Pimpleton.
She reveals how she stole letters to blackmail her way out of the orphanage. Her scheme to get away from the backbreaking chores and the headmistress was developing nicely until...
One day, a nasty, dishonest child stole my letters. I plotted my escape. I knew the exact location of the hitching post on the other side of the wall. And I had practiced with this rope for almost 2 years. Up and up I went toward freedom.
Company returns to Daisy Gamble's present life in New York. They'll capture the pulse of the town while the two stars crisscross its 200,000 acres to film one of the big musical numbers in the picture.
From the hills, from the shore, ride the wind to my door, turn the highway to dust, break the law if you must, move the world only just.
This picture marks composer Alan J. Lerner's fourth collaboration with Vincent Minnelli. Two of those resulted in Academy Award-winning film musicals, An American in Paris and Gigi.
What on earth must I do? Scream and yell, till I'm blue. Curse your soul when we do. Come back to me. Have you gone to the moon? All the corner saloon, at to wreck, at to ruin, mademoiselle, where can you be? Leave a sign on your door, out to lunch, evermore, in a waltz or a van, wrapped in mink or saran, any way that you can, come back to me.
Nelly has to keep his performers at a constant pitch so the tempo of the song never lets down. Putting together all the elements in this kind of a sequence is extremely complicated and takes 3 weeks to rehearse, set up, and shoot.
All from within, come back to me.
As the shooting reaches the stretch, more and more time is spent in the cutting rooms. There are hundreds of thousands of feet of film to run through before the form of the picture takes shape. Scenes that make the words, music, and action meaningful to an audience sitting in a movie theater. There is a part of California where 1 million tourists a year come to look at the gardens with 140 different varieties of roses. in 140 different colors. It is as pretty a setting as you can imagine for a breather or for a star to sing the title song of a movie.
Rise and look around, and you'll see who you are. On a clear day, how it will astound you that the
This is the world of the movie makers. It is a world where the creative talents of Howard Koch, Alan J. Lerner, and Vincent Minnelli are radically enlarging a stage play and enhancing the rich flavor of its story. They are working month after month at the studio and on settings like this to bring to the screen Barbara Streisand in a new musical film.